Welcome back. My name's Larry here of Xbox Live's Major Nelson. We've got the show here. We were off last week. We've got the full gang here. Laura, hello.
Hello.
How you doing?
Good to be back.
Isn't it nice?
It sure is.
Is it nice? We were back in there. It's nice.
A nice smell in here.
Up here in
I
the,
missed.
What does our studio smell like?
It smells fresh.
Fresh. And we just took the plastic off the seats, and that's why Jeff's here.
That's your fidget spinner was emanating. Actually, someone needs to make a fidget spinner that has air freshener, Febreze built into it.
Genius idea.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Or
so this way, after the apocalypse, you can still smell fresh.
That's
you can't. You don't have to count on electricity.
Febreze. That's a free.
You can
free
have that
product
one.
Idea.
You
okay, just take one. It. Take it. We got a lot of them here. Anyway, we're here for the show 604. We were off for a couple weeks. I was down
annual
in.
Leave?
I was no, unfortunately not. I was down in Anaheim at D23, which is the big Disney conference.
Totally jealous.
Right.
By the way.
Oh, it was.
My face is green.
Is it? Is it? That's what that color is.
Yep.
It was a lot of fun to be down there. You know, Anaheim is fun. It was at D23. I did an interview about Star Wars Battlefront.
Awesome.
Which Anita Gavankar, you can watch that on This Week on Xbox.
Ooh.
In fact, if you go over to your console right now and or up on YouTube or Twitter, you'll see my interview with her. So hang out with her. Didn't even get a chance to walk around the show floor.
So you didn't. You were just
no, I had
really
no
quick.
Time. I was in and out. We were prepping for a few things. We wanted to make sure we saw some things. It was just, there were so many things I wanted to see, you know, because it was all Star Wars, and then there's all the Disney stuff, mm-hmm. and the live-action movie this, and the whole, I mean, you know what it's like.
What's up with the Star Wars hotel?
I saw that.
How much is this thing going to cost?
I don't know.
Did you see this, Laura?
Did you hear about this, Laura?
I heard the headline, did not read the
but
details.
But did you read the details?
No.
Where apparently, when you check in...
Like, you assume a new identity.
You're going to cosplay. You're going to cosplay.
Yeah. So. You're going to be, yes, Laura Starkiller.
Right.
Awesome.
Right?
That sounds much better.
So I was like, if you noticed on Twitter last week, I was pleading with Disney. I'm like, Disney World people, you know how to find me because we need to take the show down there.
We do.
And apparently there's not going to be any windows in this hotel. The conceit of this is that you're going to be on a spaceship. So all the windows will show space, like you're on the set of whatever. Star Trek.
That
feels very Star Trekian.
That sounds good, but I kind of want a window. I mean, otherwise, it's like you might as well put it in a basement.
Well, maybe it will be.
Well, it's right.
Who knows? You know, hopefully it's under attack and it shakes a little. I don't know how it's going to be, but it sounds very Westworld-y.
Yeah, it does.
Mm-hmm.
Which means, I mean.
What could go wrong?
Yeah.
What could go wrong?
Please have robots.
So I got to tell you this funny story. I get down there and, you know, I had a few minutes, so I went out to In-N-Out Burger, which
is,
I've done that in the past.
We've talked about this, Larry.
No, this is funny. I go down there and my producer and I, we were going to have a production meeting. And
At In-N-Out Burger.
So I get in and I'm a very nice gentleman from, I don't know where he was from, somewhere in Europe / the Middle East. And this older gentleman, we're talking, tell him where we're from Seattle. And yeah, we're just doing this and we're going back tomorrow. Drops us off. So the next morning I, you know, do everything and then I'm going back to the airport.
Mm-hmm.
So I open up my Uber app and I put in, going to the airport, call an Uber. It's the same guy.
Oh.
Really nice.
I've never had that happen in my life.
And he gets out of the car.
Mm-hmm.
And I see that it's him, and you know, we see each other through the thing, and I smile, and he smiles at me. He gets out in the right in the front, you know, in the pickup of the hotel. He says, "No, no, no, Mr. Herb, no In-N-Out today. You're going home. Let's go." I said, "All right, let's go." So it was just funny because I've never had that happen before.
Yeah.
It was just a nice, fun moment. So
really
anyway, D23 was a lot of fun. Watch the video, and then hopefully we can go down sometime and see. And see Star Wars Land and all the
absolutely.
Battlefront 2 looks really good.
I will tell you a little disappointing thing. Can I tell you?
Yeah.
Have you been to Anaheim or Disneyland, Laura?
I've not been to Disneyland.
Okay, you have. So Disneyland for those like I grew up on the West Coast, Laura.
You grew up on the East Coast.
On the East Coast, thank you.
Don't change your story.
No,
Mr. Herb.
I grew up on the East Coast, which everybody there goes to Florida. And I don't know, because growing up in Texas, you're kind of in the middle of the country, Laura.
You are in the
so
middle.
So what? Where did you? Did you go Disney World or Disneyland?
We went Disney World.
Okay, so
we
you were
from Texas to Florida.
Okay, so Disney World is, for those of you on the East Coast that have never been to Disneyland, Disney World is massive, 25,000 acres, the whole nine yards.
Mm-hmm.
Disneyland, much smaller. You can see it from the street.
Mm-hmm.
It's a different experience. Anyway, it's definitely a V1 to Disney World's V2. Well, you can see what was the Tower of Terror,
mm-hmm.
which is an iconic ride, has been, and mm-hmm. but they've completely redressed it as Guardians of the Galaxy, and I'm disappointed because can I show you the picture?
Yeah.
Because I was so I took a picture of it. And I texted to a friend of mine who's a huge Disney fan. I was just really disappointed that this is what the back of it looked like. So I don't know where it is here. Do I have it here?
You don't remember that iconic scene in Guardians of the Galaxy where they dropped and then they rose up and then they dropped again? Did that happen in that movie?
I do have this though. I check this out. There was a land speeder out in front, and it was signed by Laura.
Lando.
Billy Dee Williams.
Yes. It works every time.
So, I don't know. For some reason, I don't know why I took a photo of it. Anyway, it was a good. It was a good time to be at D23 and look for that on This Week in Xbox. Star Wars Battlefront 2 looks amazing. Coming to Xbox One, Xbox One X later this year. We'll be playing that, and I'm sure we'll play that a lot
playing
of fun.
Playing that on EA Access, I'm sure.
EA Access, you get to it early, Jeffrey.
We're
going to get into what we're playing. We talked to Laura's probably playing Diablo 3.
Skip.
Am I right?
That's right. I'm also playing another game as well.
What are you playing?
So it's not just Diablo
time. What are you playing?
So I have been playing Diablo 3. I did want to mention that I finally hit level 70 with my Necromancer, and that's a big achievement.
I don't have any with me, but imagine my hand going, confetti.
Yay. But not only is it an achievement, it's also a rare achievement.
Oh, you love that sound, don't you?
I love that sound. It's a great sound. It's also really fun to see that pop up, and instead of a normal achievement.
Well, yeah, because the diamond spins
the
around.
Spinning around.
And the flourish, because I remember when I worked on that audio piece, Jeff, you and I talked about this, is that it was, I remember playing for you the different audios.
There was one where it just went, yay! And like you were at a kid's birthday party and they whacked the pinata. Like,
yeah, but we've already done that in Halo.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, oh, it was very much.
That was
maybe I'm thinking of that. That
grunt
setting.
Birthday party.
I love that.
Yeah, I tell this story before, but I'll tell it here. I don't think I've ever told it on the air. Is the original sound, what they wanted for the achievement was the, and Laura, I've talked to you about this, was the sound that you get from Antique Roadshow when they reveal how much the item is appraised at.
So that was the original
it was
sound.
It was kind of like a xylophone ring. And they came up with that, and I remember looking at them in the office going, no, this is what it sounds like. And they didn't know, and so I go to YouTube and I pull up a video. I'm like, I don't want to sound like we got the proper bid on a 200-year-old chest.
Yeah.
Okay? That's not what this is. Or a clock, or a Victorian brassiere. Right? You with me on that, Jeffrey?
What?
So anyway, so I'm glad you enjoyed that. So yeah, what else are you playing?
So I also got a chance to check out What Remains of Edith Finch.
Out this week on Xbox. In fact, we've got an interview later on with the developers, so we don't want to talk too much about it because it is a story-based game. We don't want to give too much away.
So this is similar to a story games like Everyone's Gone to the Rapture or...
What was that other one?
Gone Home, yes.
What was that other one we played that was started on a ferry? Oxenfree.
Oxenfree was great.
Right?
Yeah, I love that game.
Right. Yeah, Oxenfree is really good.
Right.
But it has less, I'd say, less interaction than Oxenfree.
Yeah.
For this game, you do... It's basically a progression that you walk through
and
you experience this story in the shoes of the protagonist.
Yeah.
And you do
and there's multiple protagonists.
There is.
Right, in this game, right?
Spoiler.
Well, we'll talk about it later on in the with the interview.
But I don't know if your interview will cover this, but what's awesome to me is that it's set in the Pacific Northwest.
Right.
It's set on Orcas Island, which is just, a few hours or a plane ride away, very, very close.
Depending how you want
to go. It looks a lot like the area around here. So I was able to really put myself in the shoes of this and imagine myself like walking around, the area that we live in and seeing, the story unfold.
Mm-hmm.
Like specifically, they even have the right flowers in there. I don't know if you, at the very beginning,
I did not realize you were an accomplished botanist, Laura. This is, I didn't even notice. It's funny you say that because at the very beginning of the game, you're walking down the driveway and there's some flowers and I actually went over them like, oh, this is pretty. I wasn't like, oh, this is pretty. I've seen before. I'm like, oh, this is nice.
Yeah, that's native flowers to the area. It's called foxglove.
Okay.
And they only bloom in the summer, so I can tell you exactly.
I feel like I got those in like Skyrim.
I don't
collected
even
a bunch of Laura, foxglove.
This is a little. I did. You and I are pretty good friends. I did not know that you were a florist, a botanist.
A botanist. No, I'm not a botanist, but I do enjoy gardening and growing flowers and things like that. So I've grown foxglove in my garden before.
Okay. Oh, Laura, how does your garden grow?
Exactly.
That sounded unnecessarily creepy. I apologize.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well,
this is not the first time.
Want to give props to the artists of this game. They did a very good job of capturing the Pacific Northwest, especially at the beginning of the game.
Yes.
And you walk through the very long driveway of this house and you get inside
the
house.
And the story is setting up as you're walking through.
It's setting up as you walk through. And it's one of those games that really involves you, gets you hooked from the moment you turn it on.
Mm-hmm.
Like everything about it, it makes you want to know more.
Mm-hmm.
I love how the story and the text appears inside the world.
Yeah.
And
it's almost like augmented reality.
It is. It's almost like augmented reality where as the protagonist narrates, as she narrates her story, you see the words appear on the signs or along the path. And when she's done saying that sentence, then the character, instead of just disappearing, they actually fall down and on the ground
melt
and bounce
away.
And they, or they bounce away or they get blown away in the wind. Like it's really, really well
so
done.
We don't want to say too much more.
Yeah. But this is Giant Sparrow is the developers, mm-hmm. their first game on Xbox. I think it's only their second game ever. They had a game called The Unfinished Swan, which I played back in my, I think it was on PS3 days, which was also really cool and sort of like an early quote-unquote walking simulator. Actually, mm-hmm. it was very similar to Beyond Eyes in a way, where you sort of unveiled things as they went along. But really great to have them having a game for us on Xbox.
Okay. Yeah. We'll have that interview later on. We'll go through some of the headlines now and what we're playing, but we'll play that later on, if that's all right with you, Laura.
Oh, sure thing. So I'm very interested to hear the interview.
So you're really playing good. That. Mm-hmm. I'm playing that as well. The other thing I'm playing... I'm sorry, are you done?
I am done for
okay. now. Okay. Playing that. Of course, playing Overwatch. Jeff and I have been playing a little bit of that. Started playing the Destiny 2 beta, which hit earlier this mm-hmm. week for Xbox fans. Jeff and I, we're going to try to play that tonight, right?
Yeah. I've already completed the first level, which is what was shown, I think, during E3. The Activision showed it off. It is really impressive to actually play it. And then I played through The Strike last night as well. So, so far, so good. Like mm-hmm. what I got. It looks really good. Like, visually, it's very impressive game.
Yeah, I enjoyed it. And I actually stopped playing it last night because I knew that I was going to play it with you.
All right.
Probably tonight or whenever.
I'll escort you through.
Cool. So what would you say are the differences between Destiny 1
and
Destiny 2?
Oh, boy. Jeffrey?
I don't know if they're using a different engine, but the game, it definitely felt smoother. I was playing on a TV that I didn't have previously, but man, it just looked really good.
Awesome.
As far as the feel, most of the feel is very similar, and it's just the beta, so a lot of the stuff mm-hmm. is not in there.
Yeah.
In fact, a lot of stuff looks very
familiar.
This build's
probably a month old or so, for sure.
Oh, yeah, at least. So, like you end up getting a legendary. Actually, you get an exotic rifle. Like pretty much is just handed to you very on end. And like going through like the equip menu and all, it looked exactly the same. I'd imagine. We can't judge the final product until we have that, and it's less than 2 months away. I think it's September 6th. So but it just, if you wanted more Destiny, and I know many, many, many of us did.
You do.
It's coming. So
awesome.
It felt like the things that worked well. And I would say that the first mission, this campaign mission, is definitely more epic than any of the campaign missions that I played in the original Destiny. So,
and here's a little bonus for those of you on Xbox. If you're listening to this now, the first weekend, this weekend of the beta, it's available for free.
That's right.
Not only that, but it's a free gold weekend. So you can actually check out the game and play it multiplayer for free, Jeffrey.
That is correct. And it's funny. Let's say you play through that strike multiple times. You play in the Crucible. You have all that kind of fun. There's another game that is actually free this weekend as part of the free gold weekend, and that is Doom.
Doom.
So Doom is putting out a big update, the 6.66 update. Very funny.
For
those of you who read the Necronomicon here and listen to the podcast. It's a free weekend for both Gold and Xbox Live Silver folks as well. And it'll let you play the first two levels of the campaign, but then also makes all the DLC available to everyone. And I believe... for everyone can play the multiplayer, regardless if you have the game or not. Yeah, you'll be able to. And then you can even just buy it for $14.99 if you like it. And this is a shooter that was rated just about as good as it gets last year. And a very crowded shooter year last year with a lot of amazing shooters.
I finished that game. Good.
People really like Doom.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was
really
good.
If you didn't get a chance to try it, this would be the weekend to do that.
So if you're looking for something to do, we got you covered. Not going to Comic-Con. Should I talk about Comic-Con?
Yeah. If you're not going to Comic-Con, you know, these are the things to do.
If you are going to Comic-Con, I will be there Saturday, the San Diego Comic-Con, which is it's the legendary con down in San Diego. And I will be there Saturday at 11 a.m. I will be hosting the Crackdown 3 panel.
Awesome.
I will be handling that, as well as joined by Terry Crews. So Terry will be, of course, he's in Crackdown 3,
mm-hmm.
And he will be joining us on the panel.
He's just perfect for that role.
You think?
Really? Yeah.
Okay.
I think so.
Okay. I agree. But so we're looking forward to that. I'll be hanging down at, I'll be there most of the day Saturday doing a bunch of other stuff as well. I'm doing a stream Saturday night, Laura.
All right. What are you streaming?
I am going to be streaming with Entertainment Weekly. I'll be hosting their official stream.
Today. What's hot? Are you doing these?
I don't know what we'll see. I'm going to have a lot of fun there. Janina Gavin Carr, who I interviewed last week, is going to be joining me.
Cool.
You
two are becoming good friends.
Apparently we are.
Yeah.
So now I just need to get into a Star Wars game/movie.
Exactly. Or if, you know, if they bring back True Blood.
Yeah, I'm also a role in that. So yeah. Anyway, we're doing that. And well, yeah, on Entertainment Weekly, you know, it's no big deal. Just a,
right, just, you
just
know,
Entertainment Weekly just at Comic-Con.
Just
hosting the stream, Laura.
Yeah, that's pretty sweet.
Woo. Sometimes I was like, wait a minute, what did I sign up for? Oh, God, I'm nervous. Right. So anyway, so you can tune in and watch that on mixer.com/Xbox. You'll host it there. We'll take your questions. You'll see what's tuning in. I think the kids from
Stranger Things.
Yeah. I've asked to see if they can stop by because apparently they're Xbox fans.
Really?
I want to see them and whatnot. So.
My goodness.
Yeah.
That would be awesome.
Because there's a couple of reasons. Because they're playing kids growing up in the 80s, which was what I was. So I mean, I want to talk about that. So
just lie to them. Tell them we're coming up with a Gorgon-based video game or something.
I'm not there. They're
maybe Xbox, they can make one.
They're Xbox fans. They want to come by. So anyway, looking forward to that. So I've got a busy weekend ahead of me, Laura.
That's right. Are you planning to dress up for Comic-Con?
I don't. I really don't. No. I just, you know me. I'm not a Halloween guy. I'm not a. I am every day. I get to, you know, I get to be what I want to be, and I have fun, and I don't want to pretend to be anybody else. I love being me.
Suppose you'll dress up as Major Nelson.
Yeah, that's exactly.
We should all get to that state of enlightenment. Really,
it's being centered, Jeffrey. Yes. It's being centered.
Embrace tranquility.
Thank you. It's my zenyatta.
This is another thing you can do this weekend.
What
if
is
you're
that?
Not if you're not at home,
right?
Playing both Doom and the Destiny 2 beta. If you're not at San Diego Comic Con,
right?
If you are in places like L.A., Santa Clara, Miami, or Oak Brook, I'm assuming that's Illinois.
Yeah.
I don't know if you saw, but Xbox One is now the official console partner of Real Madrid. And that's a soccer team. You're looking
Thank
at me
you.
Like,
I know,
you're
Jeff.
Like, I know Madrid is a real place. What do you mean?
You know, we forget. I used to play soccer professionally.
Real?
I used to run. I was one of those boys running around in shorts. And then I just got older and said, I can't do this anymore.
Well, I was not aware of this.
I wasn't either.
No.
But I did play.
I have seen photos of you in short shorts, but you were not kicking a ball.
And you're, yeah, I won't.
Everyone wore short shorts in the 80s.
I have bleached that from my mind.
Yes.
It's gone.
I wish I could.
I will not retrieve.
If
really, Laura? Really?
We need the Men in Black flashy thing.
Blink.
So anyway, in honor of this, there's going to be FIFA 17 fan tournaments at the Microsoft store. I'll link out to it in the notes below.
Oh, I've been to that Oak Brook store. That's nice.
Is it really?
It's a beautiful mall there. It's like this outside thing. It's where the corporate headquarters are for McDonald's.
And there's actually going to be a special Real Madrid fan tournament in the New York City flagship store on Fifth Avenue, which I was at this week.
You were just there earlier this week.
Yeah, I came by to check out the Mixer NYC studio. And
oh, you've never seen it?
No, it was
amazing. Bananas, isn't it?
Well, here's the thing. It was like 1,000% humidity there this week.
In
and I was like, they're like, do you want to see the studio? And I've been in video studios before. They crank the AC. It's in the 50s. I was like, please, let's do it.
And it's a walk-in.
And
it's
stood
a freezer.
Under the vent. It was amazing.
And that is, I told you on Twitter, we need to do a show there. Would you come to New York, Laura?
Of course I would.
Yeah, I love New York. New York is my, I adore that city and I need to go back. We need to go back and do a show.
My favorite dim sum restaurant opened up a New York edition, like from Hong Kong.
All right.
Yeah.
So you can take us to dim sum.
We're going to Timo Wan. We're doing it. I'll do the ordering.
Thank you.
We just need to get invited.
Larry's not.
That's all we need first.
Here's the thing about Larry. Larry's a meat and potatoes guy. Loves a good burger. I bring him to this place. He'll be like, you were right. I like a pork bun.
I'm open.
Okay.
I'm open.
Yeah.
They're too bunny. They're not enough porky.
You're not getting the good. you're not having the good ones.
Anyway.
Well,
so Real Madrid, where is this taking place again?
Real Madrid is having this U.S. summer tour. I think it's called the International Champions Cup. They're a huge team worldwide. This is their preseason. They come over here and they play other either MLS teams. I think they're playing the MLS All-Stars at some point in the next couple of weeks. They're going to be playing other European teams that are over here. And they're going to be in Santa Clara, which is in the Bay Area of California, L.A., Miami, and apparently in the Chicago area, Oak Brook. And so, and in New York. So what will happen is we're going to have these different FIFA games, and then you have the chance to win tickets to one of those matches in real life.
That's delightful. Cool.
So anyway, I'll link to that.
Please do.
And there's a lot going on, but I think that's kind of a cool connection. Microsoft as a whole already had a connection with Real Madrid, a partnership, and now that extends into Xbox.
Thank you for that. So you got a busy weekend this weekend, wherever you are, whatever you're doing, as long as you have your console or in the San Diego area or any of those above mentioned places that Jeff went through, we've got you covered.
That's right. Lots of games this weekend.
Lots of games.
Say hi to Cristiano Ronaldo for me. He's not my favorite player.
The women everywhere just gasp.
They do. They do. Whoa,
really? He's not your favorite player? How can that be, Jeffrey?
Well, you know. I'm more of a Barcelona fan.
Jeffrey's more of a pork bun fan.
Yes, exactly.
All right, we're going to take a break here. We've got a wonderful interview.
That's right.
A wonderful interview.
Looking forward to this interview.
This is an interview that, I've been looking forward to for a while. As Jeff said earlier on, that the game What Remains of Edith Finch, What Remains of Edith Finch, it's available on Xbox, first game. Had a chance to talk to someone from the studio. So what do you say we roll that now, shall we?
Yeah, let's listen.
What Remains of Edith Finch is out on Xbox One very soon, like within the next week or so. Joining me on the line right now is Ian Dallas. He's the creative director of Giant Sparrow, the developers behind What Remains of Edith Finch. Ian, thank you for joining us.
Oh, my pleasure.
Now, it's really exciting. The game has been out for a little while on another console on PlayStation and PC. It's coming to Xbox One. It's coming out next week. What is the date of release, by the way?
It's going to be out on Wednesday, July 19th.
Now, this has been a very, very well-received game. Tell us, for those folks on the Xbox side who haven't had a chance to really look at it, maybe they've heard a little bit about it, walk us through what this game is about, because it's a very interesting approach that you guys have taken.
So the game is, at a high level, it's a collection of short stories about a cursed family in Washington State. And you play as Edith Finch, who is coming back to the house that she grew up in and trying to figure out why she's the last family member left alive. And as you're exploring this house, in each of the bedrooms, you'll find a different story about how that family member died. And then you get to play as that family member, kind of living out the last moments of their life. And one of the things that makes this game really unusual is that each of those stories that you play is essentially its own entirely different game with its own set of mechanics, often gameplay that people have never seen in a video game before. So you're kind of going in. It almost looks like a walking simulator at first, where you're exploring this house with all the secret passages, and then suddenly you find these stories, and it's like sort of Alice in Wonderland. You're falling down the rabbit hole. It's just a crazy bunch of totally different games that give you an insight into how this family lived and ultimately died.
Now, this is also a challenge, when I do interviews like this with some story-based games, because you don't want to give away too much, for obvious reasons, no spoilers. But I want to talk about, at least before we get into some of the story, as much as we can, about the art style and really what you were, as a creative director, what you were going for in the art style in What Remains of Edith Finch.
Yeah, I mean, I think overall we were trying to go for variety. This is a game where, there's 13 different family members and they've all got their own kind of personality. And we were trying to make each of the stories feel distinctive, but then also kind of bind that together and feel, like you're playing one game, which is obviously a bit of a challenge. It's sort of like the Twilight Zone, which is, one of the inspirations for the game. Trying to make something that feels, like every episode is different, but you still have something, some continuity to it. And, initially, because the game was inspired by, a lot of like ghost stories and, kind of surreal tales, we were looking at something that felt very stylized, like almost cartoonish in a way. Like each of the stories was, very, very unrealistic, because the stories, are dealing with things that are, potentially sort of magical, and it's a little unclear what's going on. And then, something very strange happened about midway through development. We ended up hiring a lead artist, Brandon, who came from the Call of Duty team. And he's like fresh off of the latest Call of Duty, which is not, where you might expect to find, kind of an indie lead artist from. Yeah. But, he just ended up being a really good fit and, a little militaristic, actually, in the way that he approached things of like, all right, just give me 100, things to model, like lampshade and easy chair and whatever, and I will like crank through those things. And he just did a phenomenal job. And, Brandon's really interested in lighting. Right. And so what ended up happening, like artistically with the game, after Brandon joined, is that the house section of the game, which is about like half of the game or so, you as Edith exploring the house,
sure,
ended up becoming, quite realistic looking. So even though there's a lot of the stories are quite stylized, the art style for the rest of the house ended up being, you know, not like Call of Duty. I'm not gonna say it looks like right. Call of Duty, but, you know, it looks like someone who had been making Call of Duty for a number of years had been given, you know, the challenge of making something that feels much more dreamlike, right. You know, and that's kind of, we ended up with this house. It's really beautifully lit. The Unreal 4 engine does a great job of realistic lighting. And yeah, so we've got this kind of hybrid of half the game looks, you know, quite realistic in some ways, and then half the game looks, you know, like a fantasy.
Now, we talked about the art. Talk about some of the inspirations. You talk about some of the stories that maybe you made a reference a moment ago about some, you know, real life stories. Tell me about some of the real life stories that you used for the inspiration for some of the stories. I mean, it's a little macabre to talk about, but, you know, maybe for the deaths or at least some of the storylines.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's a little weird to say since, you know, all these Finch family members are dead and a lot of them die quite young. But, you know, the game broadly was based on my own childhood, like okay. what it felt like for me growing up in Washington State. And, you know, my family is more or less alive at this point. But, you know, what it feels like basically to be a child in the forest, for example, like the kind of an initial inspiration was my memories of scuba diving in Washington State and sure. feeling, you know, like you're very small and you're in an element that is, you know, quite like an area that's quite beautiful, but also a little overwhelming. And so, yeah, the game is this, you know, kind of strange hybrid of things I remember. So, for example, like the importance of salmon, like in Washington State, if you grew up, you end up eating a lot of salmon, you yeah. know, it's just like, it's around, it's part of that culture. And, you know, because a lot of these things are, you know, the stories are very dreamlike, I wanted to ground them in things that felt very familiar and intimate and kind of mundane. We talked about it as feeling a little bit like This American Life, the NPR show, like something sure. where you can really feel a human recognizable element that balances out. Because that's like trying to make something that feels surreal, you're always in danger of it feeling just nonsense and kind of random and arbitrary and kind of Ren and Stimpy like almost. No offense to Ren and Stimpy.
Yeah.
But, you know, we want something that was just like a little more grounded. So, you know, like growing up, one of the things that I remembered was, you know, what it felt like to be on a swing set and that kind of freedom. And so one of our stories, for example, like takes place on a swing set and they, you know, usually things happen in the stories that didn't happen to me personally, but the kind of initial seed was these memories that I had, like the things that stood out most from my own childhood.
And it's interesting because you talk about it taking place in Washington State here in the United States. And I actually live here now. I've lived here for about 15 years working at Xbox. And I was looking at some of the screenshots and not growing up in this area, I could actually see it. And then it's funny because I actually am a diver, a scuba diver. So when you said that, my ears kind of perked up. So I'm interested to see. I haven't had a chance to play it yet. So I'm interested to see. I know there's a little bit of a beach in here. And you know,
well, you know, it's not out on Xbox yet.
Well, I know that. So. That's why we're doing the interview. So
yeah.
So I'm looking forward to, you know, I'm looking forward to seeing what that entails. Because like I say, the art styles are so different. I mean, you have some of the, obviously some of the lush exteriors with the green and the trees and the foliage. And then inside some of the, like I was looking at one of the bedrooms where it's just such, it's magically lit. You know, there's a beautiful pinks and blues and, you know, it's like a sunsetting or sunrise. So it's interesting how you're capturing all these microcosms. When you were working on that, you know, you talk about playing each of the, each part of the game through a different character's point of view. Did you take into account that maybe this character may see things one way and perhaps does another character see the same thing, perhaps slightly different?
Yeah. You know, one of the things that was a very happy discovery for us midway through development was that reusing environments and, you know, even characters and kind of repurposing things had a lot of resonance because it felt like, you know, seeing the same living room, for example, like in appears in one of the stories in the 1960s. And then, you know, Edith walks through the same living room herself, you know, in present day. Mm-hmm. And, you know, as a game developer, I was, you know, there's this pressure to reuse things because it's easier for the artists and yeah. it's easier for everybody, you know, and it's just like cheaper and maybe you can just turn it 90 degrees and people won't notice that it's the same thing even. And so we kind of shied away from that because a lot of the game was about, you know, giving things to players that were surprising and that they'd right. never seen before. And so we, you know, kind of constantly trying to reinvent ourselves. But yeah, actually, seeing things from different perspectives, especially in time, but then just even seeing the same thing multiple times, even when it hadn't changed significantly, made the world feel a lot more real.
Right.
You know, there are areas in the game that you'll see from like three or four different perspectives in different stories, because a lot of stories ended up taking place in and around the Finch house. Because again, midway through development, we found out like, oh, this isn't a bad thing to reuse, you know, a lot of, and it'll be very different. You know, like some of the environments will be rendered, you know, like in a cel shaded comic book style for one of the stories, and then, you know, other stories might be, you know, something else. So yeah, there's it's very interesting to see like, oh right, that couch, you know, was here, but then it got moved, or you know, like very banal things. Sure. Like I was at this family reunion recently with people watching videos of themselves, films from 40 years ago.
Right.
And you know, the comments were always like such banal things about like, wow, I still have that raincoat. You right. know, it's like, it's weird that objects have this life that, you know, video games I think are really well suited for, because there's so many objects in a yeah. space like a house.
Yeah. And that, to your point, I mean, when you look at an object in the 60s, obviously you can take the same art asset in a video game and weather it a little bit and age it a little bit, and it's still recognizable, but it also makes sense, because again, you're exploring a house that has history with this family.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, I want to talk about the development, because you guys have been at Giant Sparrow so committed to this idea. Tell me a little bit about the development cycle and how, you know, how you came up with the idea, and then how you moved it forward to really ultimately delivered, you know, a well regarded, highly rated game.
Yeah, backwards. Like, just, you know, we start with an idea that is very, you know, kind of abstract, but at the same time very specific, in that we start with a feeling. And in this game, it was the feeling of the sublime, moments where, like in real life, you know, you feel simultaneously like something is beautiful, but also a little bit overwhelming.
Right.
So the initial inspiration for me was, like I said, these memories of scuba diving in Washington State and seeing the bottom of the ocean slope away into a seemingly infinite darkness.
Yeah.
And the way that can make you feel, you know, kind of like impressed by the grandeur of nature, but then also, you know, feeling very small and fragile. And just wanted to explore that feeling. So, you know, the game initially started out as a scuba diving simulator, and uh-huh. you know, we started the game, you know, first day making an underwater scene and scuba diving and, you know, breathing in and out with the regulator and all that. And, you know, it's like interesting for about 5 or 10 minutes of gameplay, and then it just kind of started feeling too much to us like a traditional game, where, you know, I think as soon as players get comfortable, there's this part of their brain that switches over to like, okay, now I understand what I have to do. Let me do that thing. And how do I do it better? And like, challenge me. And this isn't a game that's about challenge in a traditional sense. I mean, it's more of discovery and exploration and just like a general craziness.
Right.
And so, you know, we looked for references in the real world for things that had done the sublime feeling well. And there aren't a lot, you know, I mean, you find like traces of things like in cathedrals, for example, like walking in that feeling you get. But, you know, I think the clearest reference we found was weird fiction. So people like H.P. Lovecraft and Neil Gaiman and Edgar Allan Poe, and stories that, you know, are kind of about people experiencing the unknown. And a lot of them tend to be, you know, kind of horrific. The people die in them. Yeah. That worked out well for us as well.
Yeah.
And a lot of them tend to be short stories as well. I think that's no accident that a lot of the references that we looked at, including things like The Twilight Zone, you know, tend to be these very brief vignettes. Like, it's just the feeling of the sublime, I think, works best when it has a short runway and then you're off, you know, into it, like a ski jump or something. And so then, you know, in the development of the game, we, you know, pivoted kind of early on from like, okay, let's do like one scuba diving simulator thing, into what if we did like a series of these stories?
Right.
And then it was, you know, like a lot of just making these crazy prototypes, you know, a lot of which didn't end up in the game. Like, I still wish we could have done the story about the infinite parking garage. I don't know what the gameplay of that story would have been, unfortunately. Like, right. That's the, you know, the rock we foundered on. But yeah, we just tried a whole bunch of different ideas, and then ultimately called out to, you know, like around 13 of these stories that kind of felt cohesive. And it's weird that the game itself, you know, ends up feeling like, you know, like they all kind of bind together. And in the beginning, that was definitely not the case. It was just like, let's try a bunch of things that feel like they kind of evoke this element of the sublime. And, right. you know, what we ended up discovering was that a lot of the stories that worked best were about characters getting lost in their own imagination. Mm-hmm. And I think part of that is because as a development team, like Giant Sparrow is just kind of interested in those sort of subjects. But then also that's kind of what the experience of being a game player is like. Like you just naturally focus on one thing to the detriment of everything else.
Right.
Like as a player, when you're given, you know, one objective, you're like, got it. I will go and kill four warthogs or whatever
right,
it is.
Right.
There's no warthogs in this game.
Right.
But like that kind of a thing.
Yeah.
And you just like, you understand completely ignore.
You understand the combat loop of the game, as we call it.
Yeah, no, exactly. Like as a player, you've just kind of been trained to focus very narrowly.
Yeah.
And so that's what a lot of these stories ended up being about. So in some ways, the game is like, you know, a version of what it's like to be a player. But I think that's, you know, any story is like you're showing up and putting on like a new costume and taking on a new role.
Right.
And that's kind of like, you know, reading a work of fiction or watching a movie or, you know, in this case, playing a game. There's that kind of element of the unknown where you have no idea, you know, what this person's life is like, but these stories give you an opportunity to live out a bit of, you know, these different people's lives.
It's interesting you talked about, you know, that, you know, where players just go in and they understand what they need to do, the combat loop, and do it again and again. And you kind of, I don't want to say solved it, but you approached it by having each of the short story having different mechanics. And then, of course, supporting that difference and reinforcing that difference with the art and the tone. And that feels like, and then, of course, what's interesting to me is that you've got all these little pods of gameplay that are dramatically different, but then you tie them together with something that everybody knows, which is the family.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's I think we got lucky in some ways that we were basing all of these stories on something that was so relatable, like yeah. the family and the way that, you know, family histories get created. And, you know, each person has their own kind of take on events. And so there's a nice sort of melding. It's like when you're making a stew or something, you throw all these ingredients in. But then there's some magic that happens when you let it boil, in our case, for about 4 years right. of development
well,
time.
Simmer. It simmers. Sort
of, yeah. Simmers. Exactly. Right. There's no rolling boil. It's just a light simmer. And so yeah, after simmering long enough, it feels like, wow, you know, this thing kind of works together. And right. The stock in this case is what it's like to be in a family. And that's something that, you know, hopefully everyone can relate to.
What Remains of Edith Finch, coming out to Xbox, coming out next week. Depending upon when you're listening to this, it either could be out now or it's going to be out. What's the date again, Ian?
It's going to be Wednesday, July 19th.
There you go. I appreciate it. All right. Ian Dallas, creative director for Giant Sparrow. They are the development house behind the highly regarded development house. You guys have a lot of games out that you've done in the past. Some really good stuff. What Remains of Edith Finch, coming to Xbox next week. Ian, I want to thank you for your time and wish you luck and welcome to the Xbox platform.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
So thank you very much to Ian Dallas from Giant Sparrow for stopping by to chat with us.
You like anyone with the last name of Dallas.
Who doesn't?
Yeah.
Like, that's a really sweet
he
name.
He was Ian Austin, Ian Lubbock, Ian Houston. San Antonio. Houston's a good one.
Right.
It doesn't sound as good as Ian Dallas.
Ian Dallas is a heck of a name.
That's pretty great. But I
Ian Padre Island?
Dallas. Dallas.
South Padre
South
Island.
South Padre.
Wasn't that one of the name of the guys in, yeah, it was in Alien. Dallas. I think it was the captain. Go ahead. Mm-hmm. Sorry.
Well, anyway, I am looking forward to finishing up that game.
Yeah.
It just hooked me.
Go through there. So check it out.
Tells a good story.
Check it out. Jeffrey, you said you had a few more interviews. There's more news going on. There's even more.
More news.
Well, there's more and more games. So if you are a Minecraft player and who isn't, there are more skins on the marketplace and a few bug fixes that have taken place for both Pocket Edition and the Windows 10 Edition. So definitely worth checking out. These skins are Interplanetary Explorers, and
ooh,
you can find that on the marketplace. gigantic. That was a game we were talking about a few years ago, and it is finally, it had been part of the preview program, or the game preview program, I should say, is now like 1.0'd. And so the starter bundle and the ultimate bundle are now available for Windows 10, I believe, and definitely on Xbox One.
Check it.
Yeah, so you should check that out. A couple of games. So since we last spoke, we have passed the Ides of July, so that means more new games for you. Thanks to Xbox Live Games with Gold.
Yeah.
So Runbo, which is a multiplayer like party game, up to 8 people can play locally. And that is, it debuted directly into Games with Gold. So make sure you pick that up, as well as Lego Pirates of the Caribbean.
Woot.
Awesome.
The video game. And another game coming out about the time you'll be hearing this, it will be the early access to Fortnite. Another game that was a long time in the making. I've been watching some streams this morning as influencers are starting to get a hold of this game. It looks really good.
What's the game about?
The game is about a zombie infestation that occurs like in these storms. And so while the weather is good, you collect all these resources and you build up like a fort. And then the storm is going to roll in at night with these zombies.
So they're storm zombies.
Storm zombies, tornado, zombie, it's a zombie tornado.
Oh.
And they're going to sweep in, and then you, four players together, you combine to sort of fight them off and live to see another day. And then you collect more resources, you level up. There's some very interesting looking character models. It looks good. And and the streams that I was watching, it looked really good. So this is something I think I'm going to be playing. We should give this a shot.
That sounds pretty fun. Yep. Is it more real time strategy esque?
There are elements where you're building in real time. You're not, but you're controlling. It's a third person shooter.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So you're manipulating, you know, panels of wood or traps or things like that. And it looked like there was platforming going on. You know, I think there's a lot. I mean, at its base, it's like, okay, build in the daytime, fight monsters at night. It's kind of almost like Minecraft, but it seems very different than Minecraft. More, I mean, you have guns, first of all, and there's different character classes. The character models look really cool. I'm excited for this one, so I'm looking forward to playing that this weekend.
So it comes out in preview.
It's early. I believe it is the earliest version of the game, and so there's a couple of different SKUs of it, if you will, where it comes with different supplies or different things. I'm just going to go ahead and link out to it, because there's a standard Founders Pack, a Super Deluxe Founders Pack, a limited edition. There's a lot of different things. So I'm just going to go ahead and link out to that page.
Thank you.
Decide which Fortnite is right for you.
Thank you for that.
And one last thing that you may see.
But wait. There's
if you're
more.
Part of the Xbox Insiders program,
yeah.
The Creators Collection is starting to make its way out to a subset of folks in this group, and so you might start to see some of these new games, these where independent creators will be able to make games through like a sort of a simplified certification process, similar in a way.
Right.
To the Xbox Live independent games program back in the day.
Back in the day.
Like, I made a game of zombies, if you recall that one. And so you're going to see that in the game section of the store. It's starting to roll out to folks in the Insider program, and we'll go from there.
Speaking of that, we had a big update last week.
Yes, we did.
You know, last week, big dashboard update. You can now customize your image.
That's right.
So you can see my custom image. You can, Laura, I'm waiting
I
for yours.
I don't have a custom image yet.
What are you waiting for? How about a flower? What are the flowers you're building?
Building.
A fox glove.
Flowers that I'm building.
Well, you are.
Or Ian Dallas.
I am kind of.
Or Ian Dallas.
That's right. I don't know. What do you suggest?
I think a necromancer.
There's tons of stuff. You can take a screenshot and figure that out. Yeah, there's. I do wish you would change it, though. I do wish you would.
Yeah. It is. It's been a while.
I mean, I had Angry Toast. How long did I have Angry Toast?
For at least 2 years.
Yeah. Oh, I had Angry Toast from launch. That was my favorite.
I see an Angry Toast, I still think it's you.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Jeff.
Yeah. So my favorite.
When I see a cup of coffee, I still think it's you.
That's usually. Yeah. No, because I kept it that. No, I made it a personal one
right.
But I do love it. Maybe I'll switch to another cup of coffee. I'll switch to different varietals. Right. Everyone will definitely appreciate that by looking at a cup of brown liquid. They'll know. So my favorite feature for this update, and this is something we've tried out and we need to try out again.
Oh, yeah.
Is Mixer co-streaming.
Co-streaming.
Yeah. So when you're playing multiplayer games and you access the guide. You're used to seeing invite party to game, for instance.
Mm-hmm. You're still going to see that.
So you're still going to see that. Right underneath that, you can see invite party to co-stream.
But awesome. Wait, what's that, Jeffrey?
Huh? So what it means is if you're playing a multiplayer game and viewers are going to be able to see both streams or multiple streams. I think it goes up to four.
Total four.
At a time, which will be perfect for Fortnite. mm-hmm. That one person can then watch all four vantage points at the same time. And with the sub-second latency of Mixer, it looks really good. I was watching when we were playing. We did this with
Overwatch.
With Overwatch, maybe a month ago when we were testing it out. And I was able to watch you, and it was so close to real time that I could have played off the stream. I was very impressed with that.
Wow, that is incredible.
So I highly recommend you try that out. Co-stream, find a buddy.
Yeah.
Find a co-streaming buddy.
Yes.
Right? Or two, or three. You could do a whole bunch of folks.
It is a more the merrier situation. It's kind of fun. And it combines the chat so that everyone can see the same chat.
Oh, that's great.
Because it will make even less sense now.
Well, I mean, when you're broadcasting, it scrolls through pretty quickly. Right. The average person probably, that's a one percenter issue, I feel like.
Thank you. That is a problem I have. Sorry.
Yeah. Well, anyway.
Co-streaming.
Yes.
lots of new features coming out, that are available now. We talked about those. Some coming out in the future. Really cool stuff coming. I got a preview of some things coming out later this year. Very excited.
So I'll link out to everything that is in that new Xbox One update. Another thing we're checking out is the sign-in via your controller.
Oh,
so this way, if you have multiple people sharing, you have kids, other folks using the Xbox at the same time, if they always use the same controller, they can just, hit that Nexus button, turn on the controller, and it signs them in, which is a great way of doing it.
That is right.
That's how we do it.
Right.
That is how we do it.
That's this great. Is how we do it.
Oh, no.
Wow. Taking it way back to Montel Jordan. The year was 1995.
Okay.
God, what happened in 1995?
Was that the stuff happened? Was that the OJ thing?
That was. Okay. That was the trial. The trial was
Windows 95, OJ.
Windows 95 was at the top of the
charts. That's actually when I started working for Microsoft.
Really?
1995, yeah.
Really?
Wait, you've not been here 22 years.
No, I started doing contract work for them.
Oh. Yeah.
Okay.
So when I was still in Connecticut.
Yeah. Actually, I know how long you've been working here because I heard a different podcast this week that you were on where you talked about having been here for 14 years.
That's right.
Or at least worked on Xbox for 14
years. That's right. Yeah.
So the podcast, I guess I should point out. It's a different team at Microsoft does. It's very... NPR style, This American Life, like really high production values. Not that this isn't, but like that very.
Because it's not.
Drove down a cul-de-sac and I pulled a 180 power slide. It's that sort of like that tone where it's like, I mean, like every inhalation is edited out in those.
I can't do that.
Really? Well, first of all, yeah,
I find it.
If you've edited video before, like you can hear, you never hear anyone inhale.
It's off. Like they do that. I've seen that on This American Life does it a little bit, and they bounce back and forth. Where the moment I start speaking, Laura, you would start speaking. They take out any breaths, anything in the middle, and our voices are essentially on top of each other. Now I haven't listened to the podcast yet that I was on, so I don't know how they do.
Yeah, it's very well. It's a really interesting podcast. They talk about some interesting stuff. We partnered with a group, but it's not like a Microsoft. Like we talk about Xbox the whole time. They talk about a lot of different topics, but this particular episode was about independent games, and it's talking about someone who was there during the fall of the Iranian Revolution in like 1979 and made a video game about it.
Wow.
It's there's some interesting stuff in there, but Larry's part of that. Larry was not there for the
I was
job.
Not in the Iranian Revolution though.
Not there at the time. But it's a really interesting podcast, so I'll just go ahead and I'll link to it
if you don't mind.
And if you want to, Larry needs to hear it.
No, I do.
Larry needs you to hear it.
No, I don't. You're listening to this podcast, the low quality one. I believe is what you call it, low rent.
Oh, no.
This is the non-NPR version.
This is the DIY podcast. Look. Can you edit that out, please?
We leave breaths in here. We leave everything in here.
Oh.
Much to the chagrin of the audience, we leave it all in. We're not taking anything out. We will spare nothing. Anything else?
No, I think that's that.
We got to do a name the game, which is we had a winner last time, finally, after the longest running one like ever.
And we did another one.
And we did another one.
And awesomely enough, I took the pity on the audience. This one was really easy.
Should we play the piece and then? Yeah. And then, okay, let's go ahead and play the.
So that was the easy name the game from last time. And you probably already guessed it, listener. The answer was Diablo 3.
Yay!
Of course, the Necromancer DLC.
Yes, one of Laura's hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of hours of playing that.
Right. So I'm sure it was a... Of course, we got lots and lots of correct
winners,
but we took them all and picked out a random person who guessed it correctly.
Who did? Who's our winner?
And the winner is Mark from Scotland.
Mark! Who may know Graham.
Maybe.
Or not.
Or not. You know, who knows? His gamer tag is a Feline Rampage.
Great gamer talk.
Awesome.
Feline Rampage.
So, Mark, wow. Here is what you've won.
What have you taken out of my office this week, Laura?
Scrounged around and somehow found a copy of this game, which, strangely enough to me, wasn't being played. I don't know why it wasn't being played.
Wait, which game?
Of course, it was also Diablo 3.
Oh, no, that's because I have a digital copy. Go ahead.
That's right. Of course, the Eternal Collection includes the Reaper of Souls expansion, as well as the Necromancer DLC.
The whole thing.
The whole thing. That's all you need.
Yeah.
That one game.
Yeah. Trust Laura. She never takes her disc out of the tray.
That's right. I also found a copy of EA Sports FIFA 17.
Ooh, sweet.
For you, Mark. As well as a copy of Halo Wars 2, the Ultimate Edition.
Wow. Look at you going. That's where my games went. What else?
I also found a copy of Minecraft Story Mode Season 2.
Fun.
The complete season. There you go, Mark.
Now for something completely different.
And I also got you a copy of Xbox Game Pass.
What?
For 3 months.
3 months of really nice all of the you. Games
very
you can
thoughtful.
Eat.
That's very, yes.
That is fantastic.
I like to reward my winners here on Name
Well, you do. You with my stuff. So so thank you for that. Anyway, congratulations, Mark. Now, you're probably listening right now asking yourself, all right, I want to win. I don't know what to do. I'm confused. I'm hurt. It's raining out. My clothes are dirty. I'm lost. My phone isn't charged.
Where are you going with this?
I'm just going through all the angst you feel when you're, you know, when you're young and whatnot. And so I wanted to tell you how you win. All you need to do is we're going to play a clip here. Mm-hmm. What could it be from, Laura?
It could be from any Xbox One game, Xbox One DLC, Xbox One back compat. Any of those games. It's not a pre-release game.
Yep.
It's not a beta.
Yeah,
so
not a beta. It's
not, spoiler
it's not
alert.
It's not Destiny 2.
It's not Destiny 2.
Yeah,
it's not a beta. It's fully released games that you can go and buy or download from the store on Xbox One.
So there you go. Let's play the clip.
All right. Here's the clip for this week. Right, so if you too want to win fabulous prizes, like Larry said, it's super easy. You just have to send us an email. Email me, lollipop@xbox.com and major@xbox.com.
Yep.
Let us know what game you think those sounds are from.
It's easy. Take all the correct winners, put them into a virtual hat and randomly choose one and boom, you could win.
You could win.
So someone right now listening to our voices has already won. They just don't know it.
That's true.
Ta-da.
That's right.
How's that for? Crazy.
Very, very, very good, Larry. So good luck to all of our listeners out there.
Please
send us an email, lollipop@xbox.com and major@xbox.com.
That's it. That's it.
It's pretty easy.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Jeff, we got anything else? Kind of winding down.
What do you want to talk about? You know, we never talked about new gadgets, and it's been a little while.
Well, I've got the new Surface Notebook, which the laptop, which I'm sporting over here in what's
beautiful.
Cobalt blue, right?
That is cobalt blue.
It is beautiful.
Yeah, cobalt blue. It's
very shiny.
So as part of my job, I have to, I am honored to give these to people, but it pains me every time because I don't have one.
You don't have one.
I really want one.
You're like me. You give stuff away all the time.
Which is good. Well, that part's good.
Do you think
I really want one.
Give one to
I was going
to
say, you're not giving anything to Laura.
That's right. If you're a giver, I could
receive.
Take one.
I suppose you are an influencer of a sort.
Especially amongst the botanical set.
Yeah. You know, it really looks good. The burgundy looks really good. I would take that one in a second.
Mm-hmm.
And even the gold one is surprisingly good looking.
They're all good beautiful. Lookers. They're all good lookers. So yeah, I've got that. I think I talked about this. Maybe I haven't talked about this, but I put the networking system on my home, the Eero system.
That's right.
I've upgraded to their Pro, which is I'm testing that. I'm all mesh all the time. If you haven't gone home, Mesh Network, there's a ton of different options out there. Ubiquiti has them. Orbi has them. A few other people have them. Mesh is fantastic at home.
That's right.
So I don't really understand how it works. I don't need to know. It just works. All I know is I plug them in and all my stuff just works.
Right. Build them up.
Build them up. Exactly. Rake them down.
And that's exactly what you want from a home networking solution.
Right.
It's just working.
It's just working.
Because I feel like I've never really had that experience with my home networking solution.
Well, I can tell you this, Laura, and I want to show this to you because it comes to the app management. I can look at the app, and I think I showed this to you before. That's a real-time view of all the devices connected to my house right now. How many
do you have 50.
50 right now.
50 right. Connected devices.
And I'm not even home yet with my laptop and my phone and some other stuff.
Right. And it's really interesting. You can look at this when you're not at home.
Right. It's all.
Why do you have a Wi-Fi connected toaster, Larry? Why do you need that?
Why don't you have one?
Touche.
I've got, all this crazy. Most, to be honest with you, there's my gaming PC, I don't want to talk. I can't really talk about much of this stuff, can I?
No.
Xbox One, what? What? Mm-hmm. No. So I've got that in there. Great system. It's a little pricey, but it is absolutely worth it. So I recommend it to whatever you do when you're upgrading your home network. Go Mesh. That's all I can say.
Awesome.
So that's really all I have with that. What else can I talk to you about? We talked about this. I don't really have much more to say.
I've got a gadget that I'm working on.
Oh, go, Laura.
So it arrived yesterday, and I haven't had a chance to set it up yet, but I just got a Roomba.
Oh.
A robotic vacuum.
That's right.
And it's one of the newer models that is supposedly a lot more fancy than traditional.
But at the end of the day, it's just got to clean the floor. I mean, how much fancy do you need?
Well.
Is it going up the stairs?
No, it doesn't go up the stairs.
Okay, yeah.
But it does do multiple rooms, and it does do carpet and hardwood floors. It can go seamlessly between the two, and it has apparently a lot more power and a lot more suction power than the previous one.
Which is what you always want in a vacuum cleaner.
So it does a supposedly better job of vacuuming.
Can it bring you out a gin and tonic from the kitchen?
Oh my gosh, that'd be amazing.
Yeah.
If only I could teach it to do that.
If anyone in this room could.
Opposable thumbs.
It's you.
Yeah.
I suppose we could add attachments.
Yeah.
Some robotic hands.
Heck of an upgrade.
Larry, I know you would ask this.
Yes.
Have you named it yet?
Yeah, that's true.
All right. No, haven't named it yet.
Okay.
Edit
that sigh.
The sigh that was
every exhalation.
Let's name it dramatic. Fred.
Fred the robotic vacuum.
Steven.
I don't know.
I'm kind of imposing. Do you think it's male or female?
That's true. Right? I don't know.
I don't know.
Don't project.
I don't want to.
That's
sorry.
True. We could go with maybe traditional
Marjorie.
I was going to say Martha.
Marvin.
I think we're somewhere
Martha.
In there.
Yeah. I like that.
I think Martha would
Marvin,
be
good.
Marvin.
Marvin the robot from
Bugs Bunny.
Judge's Guide.
No, I was going to say Bugs Bunny.
Well, both.
Oh, Marvin the robot.
Or Robbie.
Or Robbie the robot. Also a good one. That's right.
Mm-hmm. May I humbly suggest Jeffrey? Make a great butler name.
It works well on a podcast.
Did I tell you that?
Because
that name is gone. They've essentially retired that name. And Bort? I think Larry as well. Bort. Yeah. So my family was down in Disney. And, you know, they have personalized everything, those little personalized license plates and
keychains,
whatever. Yeah, keychains, all this other, you know, stuff. Mm-hmm. And apparently I've been replaced. Jeff is no longer there. I'm like, my daughter's very upset, like, because she was looking for my name. Mm-hmm. And it goes.
Did she find hers?
It goes. No, she's okay. Got a pretty
unique
name as well. It goes straight from Jaden.
Right. Uh-oh.
Thanks, Brittany.
Jaden.
To Jenna.
Oh no!
So I've been replaced by Jaden and Jenna.
Okay.
And Jeff is no that. I think if I peeled off the sticker where it said Jaden or Jenna, you would see Jeff under
now,
there.
Now it's interesting because I remember back in the day they used to have two separate stations. There would be the male names and the female names. So now they've just combined
Jaden
them.
Jaden could go either way.
Well,
either way.
Now they always have Laura, don't they?
Usually.
Yeah,
usually.
That's a classic name.
They always have mine, which is.
No, they don't.
They have the proper use of my proper Lawrence.
Lawrence?
Yes.
Okay.
Now then this is it a W or a U? And there's a whole conversation around that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And in France, I'm sure they have it.
No Jeffrey.
No Jeff.
That's surprising because I thought Jeffrey was pretty common.
Nope, we're done. Yeah, maybe in like the 80s. Wow. I think I actually looked up after that.
Did you
I
was peak
like,
in the 80s?
Well, you can look and you can see when did names peak in popularity. And it was basically from like 1970 to 1982. And there hasn't been a Jeff before or since.
Oh, that's too bad.
Yes.
Oh.
Sad face.
That is sad face.
Yeah.
Well, okay, so we're going to name it Jeffrey.
Okay. Bring back the Jeff.
Please let this is going to be the equivalent of me transferring my brain into a robot so I can live forever.
Right.
But also vacuum. And let me tell you, you name it Jeffrey, it will learn how to make that gin and tonic.
Laura, I'd like to introduce you to Jeffrey, your humble servant.
I just want the name to live. However,
you got
to
do what you got to do. Yeah.
I won't stop until Disney makes that keychain.
Can't stop, won't stop. Yes. So, all right then. Anything else we want to talk about? We look forward to the report on Jeffrey the Roomba. Jeffrey Steven the Roomba.
Yeah, there we go. So I ended up. I told you this off camera, but I got a VR device. I got an HTC Vive.
We talked about that a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, we did. That show didn't make it.
No, I think we did, didn't we?
I don't think
you
did.
Oh, okay.
It was last week.
I thought it was a couple weeks ago.
This part we will definitely cut out.
I don't remember. We didn't. Yeah. I don't
so,
know.
So I got an HTC Vive. Nice. And I've been immersing myself in mixed reality gaming, and awesome. It is really fun. I've tried it before at like the Microsoft Store and at a couple of museums, or like this Game of Thrones thing. Having it in your home, it definitely feels like the future. Mm-hmm. And you know, it's interesting because like the games that I enjoy on Xbox on like a 4K screen are very different than the games. Because I was thinking, so I've been playing this game called Front Defense, which takes place during World War II. You're in like a little foxhole.
Oh, yeah. This one sounds awesome.
And you don't move. Like, if I was playing this with a controller on a 2D screen, this would not be a good game. But in 3D, it's amazingly intense.
Yeah.
And you're basically, there's enemy troops coming down. You're in like a European sort of street. And there's like you and a couple of like AI companions. And you're just huddled in a foxhole.
So what do you have to do? Stay alive?
Stay alive. Basically, right. They're coming in and you've got a machine gun. It looks familiar, like a from playing like Call of Duty and Battlefield and stuff. And like you shoot until you're empty, and then you literally take your left hand, you pull the clip out, you grab another one off your belt, jam it in, and you keep going. There's a battlement there, but it's sort of like a machine gun, like
a
turret, yeah. And you know, so sometimes I'm like one-handing that, and I'm keeping the machine gun in my left hand in case
you're
I need to.
You're dual wielding?
I'm dual wielding.
My Lord.
You know, and then occasionally a vehicle will come in, and then you actually have like a rocket propelled grenade that you pick it up, you load the missile into the back, and but a lot of times you're like wincing, you're like,
put a link into the show so people can do
it. I don't know. It's just so immersive. A game that, it like certain things that, I mean, even stuff like carnival game type stuff is just really fun in VR. So anyway, I'm enjoying myself, and I'll report back if I play anything super intense. Actually, I started playing Arizona Sunshine, which is like a zombie game. And
right.
Awesome. That one, like one of them I missed, and I emptied my clip and it was coming at me, and I like freaked because it like lunged at me, and like you like viscerally recoil.
Because it feels so real. It's coming at you, and you don't want it to come at you.
You
so
do
you
not.
Have
no,
to,
exactly.
Your brain says evade, and you do.
Yeah. Right. So there's some interesting stuff out there, but definitely
enjoyed
it.
Have you played Space Pirate Trainer?
I have. That was literally the first game I got. Yeah, and it's just a lot of fun. I know it's something that E was a big fan of, and he talked me into it. And you just feel very empowered. You just get into it so much.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There you go. Yeah, I've got the Vive at home as well. Yeah. I just haven't.
We should play some multiplayer stuff. Right?
I didn't know you did.
I talked to us about this last year. Yeah, I've been playing a few things. I just haven't had. I don't have in my particular home office where I have my gear set up. I just don't have the large play space.
Okay.
So it's restrictive and so I need to get a bigger house. Isn't that the way it works?
I think my house is probably smaller than your.
It is,
your West Wing, but we did clear out enough space to make it work. It doesn't need a ton.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. That sounds super fun. Yeah. I'm glad you're getting into it.
You work up a sweat, I'll tell you. Like, I'm like down on my knees. I'm like hunkering down behind these sandbags.
You're physically hunkering down.
That's yes. Right, that's right. Because we went to dinner with Jeff last week. And my wife and I went to dinner with him. We met him down near his house. And he was on time, but it was rather warm that evening. And I just chalked up. Because remember, I asked you, did you walk down?
I didn't know what you were getting at.
Because you look a little... a little tired, a little worn. Your hair was a little askew, and I was like,
"No, I've been in the Vive for about 2 hours straight."
You were apparently in a foxhole 10 minutes before.
Yeah. So. War never changes.
Thank you.
Yes.
All right. Well, I think we've got successfully have completed the show for this week. Have we?
I think we
have. Well, it's really up to you, the listener. I don't know. It's not up to us.
They've tuned out long ago.
Yeah. So we're going to have an interesting few shows ahead of us. We've got Gamescom coming up. I won't be able to go to Gamescom this year. Unfortunately, I've got a conflict, so I'm going to be taking care of that. So we may or may not be. We've got a few shows we're going to be taking care of over August. Most of the world is on holiday, mm-hmm. annual leave. Yeah. I know, Laura, you said you're going to be on annual leave. And then we'll be back. So we may or may not be doing some shows during August. We'll see. Mm-hmm. But we will be back at PAX.
That's right.
We should do some PAX streaming in the meantime if we have the
co-streaming.
Chance. Yes.
We should do some co-streaming.
Actually, it'd be a good way to have the show.
Yeah.
That would be fun.
Or something similar.
Something show-esque.
More nonsense. All right, gang. We'll talk to you guys next week whenever we can talk to you. Thank you for downloading the show and tuning in. We'll have all the details of most of what we talked about in the show. We'll put in the show notes if Jeffrey was...
Oh, they're there.
If you want to catch up with Laura and her flowers, you can find her on Twitter.
At Laura Lollipop.
If you can find Jeffrey and his cheesesteak at...
At Jeffrey Binstein.
And I'm Major Nelson. We'll talk to you guys next time. You can see me every weekend this week on Xbox on your console or on your Twitter. See you next time. Bye-bye, everybody.
See you.